So my training is now being recorded. What I'm showing you here is the training handout that is provided to you. In this training handout, we will provide you some information about what we do here. As a training service provider, we also give you a lot of training material. This training material is provided to you in a training DVD. If you have not already received it, please make sure that you receive it. The training DVD is a lot of content that is relevant for you to improve your career path into quality service. So, read as much as you can. We have a lot of training manuals. We have a lot of training books that are available in that. And I keep referring to those during the program very often. So, I will just walk you through with the training program that we have, which is supported by that training DVD. So if you look at the training DVD content, so here are the details of content that is existing in the training DVD that you would be getting. It includes information about 21 CFR Part 11. Anyone aware of what is 21 CFR Part 11? That's something to do with quality assurance in pharmaceutical industry. Pharmaceutical industry is very sensitive to quality, right? Not only do they have quality control on the manufacturing process, but also there is quality control on the systems that they use for processing. So if you were to participate in pharmaceutical industry, how would you go about doing your role as a participant for improving or working on their systems? Not the process, but this is the system side of it. So this gives you guidelines on that. Then we have a previous aggregation of batch 55 recordings available for you. We are not giving you the latest recordings for a specific reason, because when we started sharing the latest recordings for the session, they were being misused. I was started a parallel training center by using these recordings. Do you believe that? Yes, it happened. That's not where, this is intellectual property, right? So this should not be misused. So that's why we stopped giving you, but we always share what you have for your training program that is available to you. Going on to the next folder, which is talking about CMM. CMM is Capability Maturity Model, which is for improving the standard that you follow in your system development life cycle. Have you heard about ISO 9000? Anyone? Online members, have you heard about ISO 9000? ISO 9000 is the de facto standard guideline that is adapted, because when you follow the guidelines of standardized processes, you are assured of the quality of your results. Why do the American organizations follow ASA or ISO for manufacturing process or GMP in pharmaceutical industry? Right? There are standard guidelines, because if you follow those standard guidelines, the output is controlled and the end result is as expected. So when I go to a prospective client that I want to build software for you, let's say I walk into the office for a big pharmaceutical company and I am willing to automate everything for you. I can build a system that will help you streamline your processing. What is the confidence that this organization has in me? They will look at my background. They will look at what projects I have managed and what certifications do I have to offer. So in that, if I have ISO 9000 certifications that are relevant to IT, I also have CMM certification. So they will then understand that I, as an organization, is following some standards in my processes where I will have proper documentation available at each step of the way. And being a BA, I think you will understand, Praveena, what is the importance of documentation, right? So there is a standardization on documentation. There is a standardization on sign-offs. So everything is defined in that process. So if I am a CMM level certified company, it ranges from 1 to 5. If I am CMM level 5, I am expected to be top of the line in following processes. So now, if I follow the process, then the level of confidence that the organization has to be a partner with me increases. So this has some information about CMM. And there are a lot of documents that we have which are for information on, let's take a dive here. Lot of stuff. These documents are for you to use in your class, some support document that will be needed. Going back to the folder once again. Then you have a knowledge base. Now this knowledge base is a repository which contains a lot of concepts. What is client server? What is C programming? What are flowcharts? What are TCP/IP operating systems? How do I do testing? What are databases? And a lot of other information is available here. So this repository that we are sharing with you is a collection of content that we have found helpful over the years. Everything is available on the internet as well. Don't get me wrong. This is not the only source that you have. Internet is now fully enabled to provide you whatever you want for anything in life. So you can always do that as well. But when you are in an ocean, to find the fish that you need, it's kind of difficult. So this is the repository that where we have created a shallow pond for you which has all the fish that you want. So go to the ocean when you're ready. Nobody's stopping you. If you know the fish that you want is available in the ocean, go pick it up. Nobody stops you. But to improve your learning and shorten the path to reach the right fish, we have this pond for you. So this is the repository that I encourage you to use as much as you can. Coming back to the handout. Now here is some logistical information that we need to be aware of. Every unit when you are in the class is allocated a user ID and password. So the host that you are sitting on, you could be sitting on any host, has a number associated with it on the top right corner. So let's say you are sitting on machine number 1, the access user credentials will be share 1 and all passwords are welcome. For the remote students it's slightly different. So you will be accessing a remote desktop. After you get into the remote desktop, you will get a password and an ID, which is just share 20 and welcome to access the machine. Did anyone have any issues in accessing the machine? Online team members, any questions? Anyone, any response on this please? Is everyone able to access their machine?
Yeah, okay so far.
Okay, that's good. Good to hear that. If you do not tell me what's going on, I assume everything is fine. So remember that, okay? Alright? Next thing that we're going to do is, we're going to introduce you to a new concept of network attached storage. When you store information on your computer, what do? You go save a file on a folder in your system. Right? When you want to save a resume, what do? In Word, you just go save file, save as, or file save, and you're done. But now I'm going to introduce you to a new concept of network attached storage. Before we go into the network attached storage, let's take a short break so that we can charge ourselves and come back again. Alright? So, a 5-minute break, not a 15-minute break, okay? Now what we're going to cover? So now I'm introducing yourself to something called NAS or SAN. What is NAS? NAS is Network Attached Storage. So what happens is, why do we use Network Attached Storage? When you're working on your local system, everything is on your laptop or your desk.
Rina Mendonca.
What happens if your laptop blows up? Your hard drive which you are using does not function. Your computer does not work. All the data that you have on your system is gone forever. So to avoid that, corporations, organizations, enterprises provide something called SAN, called Storage Area Network, which is supported by NAS, Network Attached Storage.
cloud computing?
I don't know. Well, that's a different concept altogether. So what happens is, when you're looking at a network attached storage, you have a shared repository which will serve as a storage medium for you. So everyone will have access to that storage medium, of course, depending on the roles and rights
has
that you have.
The conference.
And you can store your information on that particular storage area. Thereby, even if your system breaks down, the data, which is the most important part, is not lost. So what we've done here, we've created a network attached storage which is residing on a server. Does everyone know what a server is?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So, Faisal, please help us understand, what do you think a server is? What does a server do?
Server is where you can put a store, where you can store all the information, and you can use it anytime you want by logging in.
Okay, now we are moving into the thick of our training program on concepts. And I need one volunteer who can take down the homework questions and broadcast it to the group. Because as we move along, there will be a lot of interactive questions that we will work on. So any volunteer, Faisal, you or Praveena or anyone in the class, I want one volunteer who will take down, the questions and send it out to the group. And I don't want you to write it in book. Write it on the computer itself so that you don't have to transport it back into the system. So my first question is, what is a server? And Faisal said that server is where you can do what?
Store.
Okay. So Faisal says server is a... Server is a unit where you can store all the information. Does everyone agree with that?
It's a database
kind
of
thing. So it's a repository where you can store and extract, right? Okay, anyone else? Hello, everyone. I want everyone to be participative. What do you think is a server?
Multiple people can access it.
Okay. So it's again a refined form of what Faisal and Praveena said. Anyone else? Whenever you answer anything, please make sure that you say your name first. Because we are still not familiar or tuned to the voice to recognize who that person is. So I would appreciate if you could say your name first and then give your answer.
Sorry, Ashish.
Yeah, go ahead. Who was that? So Praveena, you were saying something.
Server is a place where the data is stored in a data table, not in general. Like, we have data modeling and then the data is stored in it.
So what you were talking about, in specific, is database server.
Mm-hmm.
So the database server has what you just mentioned. Okay. There's a data model based on which you create a repository, which is tables, columns, and rows.
Mm-hmm.
In that, the data is stored. But that's database server,
okay.
Right?
Okay.
What Faisal was talking about as storage and retrieval, it can be a database. But can it also be a file server?
Yes.
Okay. So you're storing files and retrieving files. So now what we are looking at is a server can do multiple functions. Right? So what we need to understand, what is a server? That's your question that you have, right?
Okay.
The next thing that I want you to know is, server is a piece of equipment and software together which has higher configuration. It has more beefier configuration. So you'll have more number of processing capabilities in that system. Processing capability will come with more CPU, more processing power, more RAM. Right? So you have different chipset. Like you may have heard Pentium, Pentium 2, 3, 4, Intel's Pentium, etc., etc. There's so many other hardware chipsets that are available. Then you have RAM. 2GB RAM, 3GB RAM, 4GB RAM, 60GB RAM. 256 GB RAM. These are all configurations of a system on which you have server that is running. So a server is hosted on a higher configuration machine. And server is basically in the business of serving. It can serve data, database server. It can serve file server. It can serve printing options. Have you heard about print server? Have you heard about chat servers when you chat with someone? When you go on to Facebook and you see a chat window where chat is going on with a lot of people at the same time, so that's your chat server. So based on the function in which the software specializes, that becomes that type of server. So you have chat server, print server, telephone server, telephony servers. Have you heard about web servers?
Yeah.
So what do the web servers do? They serve web pages. They serve web pages, right? So similarly, our list of questions include what is a server, what are the various types of servers, and what are the companies that make those servers, right? So this will give us a broad spectrum of one part of the technology that we should be aware of. Because based on the types of servers that are there in your application, you need to do different type of testing. So we started with a network attached storage, which is sitting on a file server. So let's go on to the network attached storage and follow the instructions that I'm doing here. So what you want to do is you want to go to this share, which you can do from here, or you can use the explorer that comes up here. You can use either of these options. To use the Windows Explorer, what you need to do is write Sandook. What does Sandook mean?
Box.
It's a box.
Storage.
Because we have called our storage by a name, which gives you another concept that the name of the storage medium can be defined. So we have given it a very Indian name. Sandook is a storage repository. It's like a trunk. So in that Sandook, we have something called training. So what you're looking at, do you notice any difference between slashes before Sandook and after Sandook? There are two slashes before Sandook and one slash after Sandook. So when you have two slashes and you write a network path, what I'm doing now is writing a network path to access. Two slashes before a name for a repository tell me that that's the server. In that server, there is a folder called training. Under that folder, training, there is another folder called QA, in which there are batches. If I hit enter now, I will go to the repository, which shows me the path which we have followed. So this is Sandook training. In that Sandook training in QA, now I'm going on to the batches. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to create a repository. Everyone is not making this repository. I'm just making this repository for batch 70. Can everyone access this batch 70 share that I've created? Can you please check? So you can now access the batch 70 repository. So what we are going to do here now is we're going to create our own individual repository in batch 70, in which we will store all the content that we work with. The idea is that you can switch machines whenever you want, but access the same repository which is on the network attached storage and still be able to do it. What do you want to do with the data? Now this is dependent on how your network is configured. You could have this network attached storage locally in the office where you're sitting, or it could be at some remote location. Now, to give you the example, for people who are remote at different locations within the continental US, we'll also be able to access this. I would be working on some repository that is residing thousands of miles away from me, and it will be seamless for me. But why do we do that? The idea is that when we go on to the network attached storage, that network attached storage is backed up on a regular basis. So what will happen by the backup? If there is a problem, you have another copy of that from which you can retrieve. Versus when you have everything locally and your system blows up, you have nothing to fall back on. This is a very important concept in IT for network attached storage. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to create a sample folder, and I want you to copy that folder and name it for yourself. So I'm just creating a folder here, which is sample. Do not do anything yet. In this sample folder, we will have separate folders that we will create for our training purpose. The first one that we will make is QC, in which we will store information about whatever we want for Quality Center. Oops, sorry. Next folder that I'm going to build here is a folder for QTP, which is Quick Test Professional. Then I'm making another folder for Load Runner. That's another tool that we cover in the training program. Then I'm going to create another one, which is for General Documents. Right? In this, you can store all the homework that you do. Alright? So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to create a copy of this for and create a name for this folder so that I can use it. So I'm going to use this name for my repository, and I encourage you to make similar repository for yourself as well. So please go ahead and create a folder by keeping a copy of what you see in sample and bring it up to speed. All right? So I see someone started already. Let's look at that. Please make sure that you make it in your name.
Yeah.
You did that? Okay, all right. Anyone else? Please, go ahead.
Hello, Ashish.
Yes, who's this?
Diana.
Yes, Diana.
I don't think I can create it right now because Amol didn't give me the he didn't create the virtual machine for me.
Okay, so let me do it for you. I will just make one for you.
Okay, thank you.
All right, everyone else, please hurry up. Let's go on to this, and we have a lot to cover here. Okay, I see some more. Great.
Hi, Ashish. This is Reena here.
Yes, Reena,
hello?
Please go ahead.
Yeah, I was assigned a machine here, but I think somebody else is using it. I'm not sure who it is, but yeah, somebody, another user connected to the remote computer.
Okay, can you IM Amol? Because you can reach out to Amol and he can help you out.
Okay, sure.
Hello,
yeah,
hello.
Thank
Ashish.
You. Yes, please go ahead.
Yes, this is Priya. Even I'm not assigned a machine.
Okay, so let me just create one for you as well. So I'm just going to create one. Here you go. So Priya, what's your last name? I would need your last name as well to create this folder.
Yeah, Priya, J-A-W-A-L-K-A-R.
Did I do it right? J-A-W-A-L-K-A-R?
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, all right. Anyone else who has a problem, please let me know and I can build it up for you.
I'm Rekha here. I'm having a problem.
Okay, so Rekha, I'll create one for you. All right, so if you give me your first and last name.
Rekha Kumar.
All right, there you go. You got yours as well.
Thank you.
You're very welcome. So we have some of the people who have created the folders here. You see any difference in this folder that have been created here? Apart from the name and the time, I'm not sure what you want to say.
No, he said if there is any difference.
Okay, so you said name and the time is different. Good observation, yeah. So everyone will have, of course, their own name here, and they created it at a different time. That's why we are seeing this. Right?
Yes.
Any other observations? Has everyone followed the standard that was defined by creating this folder name? What is the observation on this folder name? It has the first name and the last name. The first letter of the first name is cat. The rest are lowercase. Similarly, the last name, the first letter of the last name is cat. How many of us followed this? Not me, not me. Anyone else who wants to be awarded? Okay, so now the important concept that I'm bringing here behind this, let's understand that. There is standardization that is important. So we need to understand the importance of this, because when we follow standards, everyone is doing the same thing. They're not doing different things. If they follow doing the same thing, everyone can pick up what the other person was doing. Right? The idea behind this small exercise was to help you understand the importance of standardization. Right? So if I'm told that I am going to work on, let's say, Rina Mendonca's work, and I find Rina and Rina Mendonca as two separate users that are sitting there, there's obviously confusion. What do you want me to work on? If everyone followed the proper convention, then there is no ambiguity. Standardization prevents ambiguity. And when you have ambiguity, you start assuming. Anyone, do you know what is the full form of assume? I bet you wouldn't have ever heard that.
Don't make an ass of you and me.
There you go, she's heard it. A-S-S-U-M-E. If you assume, you make an ass of you and me. Now you'll remember that you don't assume anything ever. In IT, in quality assurance, we do not assume anything. We want everything in black and white. There are no shades of gray. Because when you work on shades of gray, there is ambiguity, you're assuming, and you may be assuming it wrong. Who knows? But if you're doing it in black and white, you're always doing it right. Right? You agree? So make sure that you follow this. All right. For the rest of us, have we created and appropriated everything? Sandhya, you want to change this to a proper older name. And also, oops, you guys did not follow another instruction. You were to make a copy of sample and then rename. So I created a sample and then I created a folder for myself. What do you see here? There are four folders inside. Let me look at the rest. When Vasanthi made it, she just created a new folder. She did not follow the instructions of creating a copy of the sample so that she didn't have to do additional work. Let's look at the rest. Rekha, there you go. You've done it right. Priya's folder was done by me. This is Priya, Praveena. She's done it right. Faisal, oh, sorry. Is it Faisal or Fuzzle?
Faisal.
Faisal. AI. Okay. No, which is why I'm trying to be politically correct. So I'm just asking you. Yes.
Excuse me, Ashish. I'm sorry, but then I don't think I have a remote desktop.
Is this
don't
Rekha?
Have a machine assigned to me. Yeah, Rekha.
Rekha, your folder has been created. You can coordinate with.
Yeah, you created it. Yeah, you created
it. I created it for you already.
Yeah, but then I'm not sure about the remote desktop.
You would be getting a remote desktop from Amol. He'll be able to help you with that. So, Sandhya, I don't see your folder here, so do you want me to go ahead and create it for you? Sandhya?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, so all we need to do is... Sandhya, I would appreciate if you can share your last name.
Aladi. T-A-L-A-D-I. Yes.
So, I am going to take liberty to knock this out because we don't need this here, right?
Yes.
So now you see, this is our shared repository. So whether you are sitting on Shishya 1 or 10 or 15, or you are on remote unit 7001 or 7010 or 7015, you can still access this repository and store information that you want in this location. So this is our, I encourage you to use this only for storage. Because the machines that are here in the environment are used by multiple people. There is no restriction and control. Right? So be careful on that. So going back to the next concept that we need to work on. I've shown you information on the training DVD, so you can go down to the various repositories in the training DVD and also on the share network where you find the training DVD. Next segment that we are covering here is discussing the training syllabus. This training syllabus is broken down, as I mentioned to you, a session in the morning, a session in the afternoon. There's a mid-morning break, there's a mid-afternoon break, and there's a lunch hour. So we are now going to follow the schedule that's available here. Remember, this schedule is a guideline for us to follow, to keep me honest what I cover in the class. But this can be altered depending on the training batch. Like in this batch, there are, I would say, aspirants for IT. They're not hardcore IT people who are in the field or who are coming to the industry to retool themselves. So for them, it will be a different program. For our batch, at this point in time, batch 70, we will have to tailor make it so that we have the right coverage. But I will try to cover almost all concepts for you. You may not be going hands-on on everything because you may be, you know, a little behind the curve for, you know, a lack of better word, to reach that level of excellence because you need a previous background for that concept. But I will try to help you understand as much as I can within the confines of our limited learning. So take time, go through the training syllabus. I don't want to waste time to cover the training syllabus in the information that we're sharing here. Also remember, this training syllabus is for what you do in class, but there is some homework also that you need to do, which is what we are building on. Praveena has been kind enough to start taking some notes on that, where she would share this information with us, right?
Yes.
So we found out what is a server. Similarly, I also want you to include one more question. What is client-server technology? Alright? So the next information, this student document that you have with you will be your guideline to raise any questions or concerns regarding the training program. Next thing that I want you to take care of or review is this information here. Why are we looking at this information? To understand the overall system architecture. Because system architecture is the backbone of the IT infrastructure on which every application will run. Once we understand this, then we will understand the facets of IT. How we get engaged into quality assurance. What is quality assurance's roles and responsibilities? Who are the people who are actively engaged in that segment? So we will start with that. So this is the kind of beginner program that I'm starting with you to give you a background of what an application is working on. So when you're looking at an application, for example, you're looking at what application do you use the most? Windows is the operating system. For your business, do you go to Restaurant Depot?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's one application you use. For your restaurant, do you deposit money in bank or you keep cash in your pocket? Use a banking application, right? You do some e-commerce on Amazon.com or eBay or go to a website to check when your communication is to be sent to someone like a mail client like Yahoo.
Right.
Do you ever do a search on an application like Google? So you use all these applications. These are all applications. These applications, when they get built, there are a collection of people who are responsible for various things. There are people who will do the business part of it, who will think that I need a search engine, right? That search engine will have these capabilities. It will provide a platform where 1 million concurrent users, everyone working together, can operate, right? They will get relevant answers for them. What's the benefit that I will get from them? I will use this as an advertising platform. Whosoever searches, to the relevant term, I will provide an advertiser from which I can charge money. That's what Google does, right?
Yes.
What does Amazon do? It brings you a platform to trade. So what happens on that trade platform? It's an e-commerce platform, right? There are buyers, there are sellers. Anything else? Traders, institutions, people who will provide services for payment, collection, delivery, everything comes into play, right? So an e-commerce solution is not just a solution to provide a medium for trade. It is also a platform where a lot of ancillary services are required. For example,
shipping is also
there. You go. Shipping is also a part of the solution that is required there, right? All these components that you have to build a solution need to be supported on an infrastructure. And this is a very wide 30,000 feet level introduction to a system. So when you're looking at this slide deck here, it is showing you platforms. It's not a plain platform. This platform in technical jargon or in IT is addressed as an operating system. So what is an operating system? So the OS is the software which runs on a hardware, right? Because operating system is also a software, right? What are the various types of operating systems you're aware of?
XP, Windows Professional.
Okay. Anyone else? Online team members, I want your active participation. I'm missing your melodious voices.
Mac.
Mac. Okay.
Yeah, Vista.
Vista.
Yep.
Anything else?
Windows.
Microsoft Windows has multiple options, starting from Windows 95. Anyone heard about that?
Yeah.
And now we've come to, what is the latest?
Vista.
So we need to find a list of all operating systems that you can get. All what we are talking about now is our laptop or a desktop. Are there any other places where you've heard about operating systems? We have handheld devices which use operating system like Android. An iPhone, which also has an operating system. BlackBerry also has an operating system. Palm also has an operating system. And I can go with this list, which is endless. So all these systems have operating systems, right? And we need to get a collection, or at least a fair understanding, of the available operating systems. And make sure when you write the list of operating systems as an answer for this, classify it that this is for desktop, this is for handheld devices, and these are for mobile devices. iPad, that's another big word now. iPhone, another big word. Droid platform, another big word. Android operating system, right? So, what we are looking at is the platform. So, the platform is basically the aspect on which you are running your application. There are various application service, various operating system providers. Microsoft is one, then Sun. Anyone heard about Sun? Sun Microsystems, very good. But now Sun Microsystems has been overtaken by whom?
Oracle?
There you go. So Oracle has bought over Sun. It is under the same umbrella now. What is the operating system that Sun offers? Everyone knows about... Sorry, what was that?
I didn't get your question.
My question is, Sun Microsystems offers a platform. What is the name of that
Java.
Platform? Java is the technology on which you can build applications. Java is not an operating system.
Okay.
The Sun provides you a Solaris platform, Sun Solaris, which is
okay.
A variant of a Microsoft competitor, Unix. Anyone heard about Unix?
Yeah.
So Unix is one platform. Microsoft is one platform. On Unix, there are various service providers. Unix is an open source system which has been configured by various vendors. Some, when they configured the open source Unix to suit their needs, they called it Solaris.
Is it outdated or is it still?
Oh, it's very much prevalent now as well. Lot of organizations, you'll be surprised, are on Unix. Right? And it could be a variant. Sun provides you Unix. HP, IBM also provide you Unix, but they provide their own flavors. Then there is Linux. So the world of platforms that you have comprises of Microsoft, which is a big word, then non-Microsoft. Under non-Microsoft, you have Unix and Linux. Of course, there is Mac world as well now, right?
Mm-hmm.
So when you go and do this research, you'll find a lot of other operating systems as well. So that's your backbone on which you start working on your computer sitting at home. When you're trying to access the internet, what happens? Let's take a big example of trying to access 1-800-Flowers. So when you're sitting at home, you're trying to access 1-800-Flowers website from your home, what do? You open your computer, which is running a platform, right? That platform is running on some hardware. That hardware is, there is a combination of a chip, Intel, blah, 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 with 2GB RAM, 4GB RAM, on an operating system. After that, what do? You have your application to be started. Which application to start?
So
you open the browser. The next question that we have is, what are the various types of browsers that are available in market?
Google Chrome,
good example.
Firefox,
another good example. Internet Explorer. Yes, Internet Explorer. Anything else?
MSN, Safari.
MSN is, MSN actually has a lot of other options as well. It has, MSN is a website. MSN also is a chat server. So I'm not sure where you're going with that. So browser is Internet Explorer, Chrome, Safari.
Safari.
Did you say Safari? I think you said Safari. So there is a combination of a lot of browsers. So why do you have this in browsers?
To view the web pages.
To view the web pages, but then why do we have so many of them? And why did the browser change so much? Because I remember using Internet Explorer 6, and sometimes when I run that Internet Explorer 6 on a newly built application, it says your browser is compatible. Why does that happen?
Upgrading it based on the technical advancement.
Most important thing that I just mentioned, I don't know if it's intentionally or unintentionally, but it is a very important thing. It's the growth in the marketplace where technology changes. To support the upgrade in technology, we have looked at Internet Explorer, Chrome, Firefox also upgrading. So as the technology to build becomes more and more sophisticated, we need the browsers to be more sophisticated, which is why you have gone from Internet Explorer 6 to Internet Explorer 9 now. Right? Because these newer browsers are with greater speed of delivery. They are more compatible to the latest technology because you have videos, Flash, etc. that you can use, right? There are pop-ups that come up which are not allowed in the old versions of the browsers. So we need to understand, the next question is, not only what are the various types of browsers, what are the various versions of those browsers? The reason of this exercise is to understand the platform and the browsers that are required in our testing needs. Because when you are looking at an application, let's do a small exercise here. How do you access Google from your home? Let's walk it through. So first, what do? You use a computer or do you use a laptop or a handheld? What do you do?
Laptop. laptop.
Okay, so let's say you're using a laptop. The laptop has Windows.
Windows, yes.
What version of Windows? XP?
XP. Yes.
So Windows XP, IE, Internet Explorer 6, 7, 8, 9?
9.
So laptop, Windows Explorer, Internet Explorer 9. What about you, Praveena? What do you use?
I use laptop.
Okay.
Vista.
Laptop Vista, okay.
And
so from XP we've gone to Vista.
Yes.
Okay.
And Internet Explorer
9.0. Internet Explorer 9.0. Okay. Let's go on to the team members here. Diana, what do you use? Diana is not on phone, I think. Gopika, are you connected? Okay. Let's go to Nupur.
I use Windows.
Windows, yeah. What version of Windows do you use? Microsoft Windows. Are you using XP,
yeah.
XP Professional,
XP,
Vista, Longhorn?
No, Windows XP.
So Windows XP. What is the browser that you use?
Internet Explorer.
Internet Explorer version 9, 8, 7, 6?
9, Ashish.
So here we have three people who are using three different platforms. Three different browsers, three different operating systems. So when you're looking at a public facing website, you need to support the testing all these variants. That is why we're doing the exercise of understanding the components of the architecture. Because my audience, when I am Google, I will expect people to work or come onto my website from so many combinations. They'll be using handheld. They'll be going on their iPhone to do google.com and do a search. They'll be on an Android handheld. They'll be on a laptop. They will be on several other mediums. So the reason why we are doing this is to understand that when we do testing, we need to understand what is supported platform need. Because based on every platform that you add for testing, the time for testing grows. If you've tested on Windows XP and Internet Explorer 8 or 9, does not mean that on Windows 2000 it will work perfectly fine. You have to test on that as well. So that's why we're going through the exercise of various platforms, various internet, various browsers, and various versions. Okay? Next thing that we're looking at is the internet or the intranet. Anyone, you know what is the difference in internet and intranet?
Internet can be accessed everywhere globally. Intranet, in particular, specific groups or specific locations.
You're almost there. You're almost there, yes. Anyone else who wants to take a stab at this?
Internet is accessing the World Wide Web. And the intranet is accessing, they are connected to a network, suppose we take an example of a company called CTS, then all the computers are connected in a network.
Okay, for those who are not
the
worldwide
web. Internet is the worldwide web. Intranet is within the company or within an organization. Where you share information within the organization is intranet. Internet is like the World Wide Web, you know? Intranet is just within an organization.
Okay. I had requested to follow a standard. Please say your name first and then give your answer so that we know who is communicating with us. So, Praveena has something.
Rekha here.
Priya here.
Good. Thank you, Priya.
Yeah, I believe intranet.
Name first, please.
Praveena.
Okay.
And I feel like intranet, even in the same company, some locations can't access based on the restrictions we have. So in client place, we can't access the particular intranet site. Whereas in cognizant network, we can. I'm just touching upon the point.
Okay, so what she's trying to help us understand here is, one, internet is World Wide Web. You can access it from anywhere and everywhere. Which means it's open web. Can you access Google from anywhere in the world? Yes, you can. Can you access your Citibank account from anywhere in the world? Yes. Bank of America is open. ACS is open. Hotmail is open. Yahoo is open. Google.com mail.google.com is open, right? The Gmail account is accessible from everywhere. That's the internet part of it. What is intranet? Intranet is a restricted or controlled access based on user authentication. So what will happen? There is, let's take an example of City Financial Services. City Financial Services is offering you a city website, your city.com, your banking website. But within city, the corporate network of city, you cannot access that if you're not an employee. You have a different URL, the path to access. There would be user authentication that will be done. And then you'll be connected in the corporate network. Do you think everyone who is outside in the outside world, sitting outside coach, can access everything that's in the coach? No. Which means it is intranet, within an organization. That organization could be as scaled or distributed all over the globe. Cognizant network, Cognizant HR is accessible to all Cognizant employees who can access the Cognizant system with their ID. That's your intranet. Right? We know what is internet, now we know what is intranet. There's another one called extranet. Internet minus the intranet direction. Make sense? Internet is everything.
Yeah.
A segment which is intranet, if you subtract that, that's your extranet.
Okay.
So now we know the three important components. We know the operating system, we know the browser, and then we are accessing it through the internet. Right? When you access through the internet, what happens? When you try to write google.com in your browser, what happens? You see a web page from Google returned onto your browser. Somebody has the mic on their system on, and I can hear an echo of my voice.
I have a question. Is the internet or
intranet? Okay. The Netflix.com, if you look at as an entire application, it has two stages. One is where you can browse the movies. Second is you can run the movie.
There are two segments.
There's a lot of echo in the audio, yes. Somebody has to switch off their speakers. You have to switch off your microphone that you have on your side.
Rekha,
otherwise, you will continue with the
conference.
Hello? I think she has echo on the system. So, your question, when you're talking about Netflix, there are two aspects of Netflix. One, where you can just simply browse. Second is you log in into your account and then watch a movie. So what happens? What are the two stages? Now you tell me what is what.
The minute I just open the Netflix page, that's for the internet password. If I have to watch it free, then I have to just give my information and then go and watch it free for 1 minute.
That's a separate thing. You just went on to a third aspect of the application.
Okay.
One aspect there is that you're browsing. You're just trying to find a movie that you're interested in.
Even when I have to browse, I have to first give my user rating.
I don't know the application, but I'm trying to understand from you what is the application.
Okay. So first, when I open this page, I have to give my username and password in order to access, view the movie list, and also, you know, if I have to watch it also. But the first step is to give the username and password.
Okay.
And once I give it, then I can view the movies and then I can pay it.
Okay.
But I wanted to know what exactly it is. It's the intranet or internet?
It's internet.
Internet. But
it is internet, like Citibank, like Bank of America. What happens is, you get authenticated on the network,
okay,
on the internet, and you are able to access your information.
Right. But there is a restriction here, because it is accessible only for U.S. services. I mean, U.S. people who are in U.S., but it cannot be accessed from any other location. Say, for example, I gave it the Israel password details to my sister in U.S., U.K., London, but she wasn't able to access because there is like a restriction, you know, location restriction something. The error message. So, in that case, it is not an internet, it is not an intranet. What is
this? Okay.
I'm sorry, you know.
Nice try. What happens is, based on your IP, you know what IP is?
Yeah.
What is IP? There you go, the IP address. The origin of the IP address, they track the origin of the IP address, and based on that, they open access for you to access your account. So if you share your credential, your Netflix user ID and password, with someone who is not from that same IP range, they'll block it.
Okay.
That's what they do.
But still it's internet.
It is internet.
Yeah.
However, if you were a Netflix employee who wants to look at the Netflix repositories within the network, or Netflix Outlook, email, etc., shared components that you have, shared network attached storage, etc., that's a different thing. That's the intranet. Right?
Yes.
Okay. Hope that makes it clear.
Yes.
So now what we were looking at is internet and intranet. When you write a name in your browser and up comes a page, you realize how much work the browser and network has done before it delivers that page? We all do not understand that point in time. Let's see what happens. Let's see something very interesting. So what I'm going to do as an exercise here for you is show you some background of what happens when a request is submitted. For example, what is your favorite website, Praveena? Most favorite website?
Facebook.
There you go. So let's say we want to understand when I write So let me bring up Facebook here. Does everyone do the same thing to access Facebook? They may be doing it on their handheld device.
Right.
They may be doing on, what are the other options? One is your laptop, desktop,
mobile
device,
iPad,
right?
Kindle.
Anything, but you're still doing something similar to this, right? And then you hit enter. There is some spinning that happens and this page comes up. So this is your user authentication. Get authenticated and go in. Let's try and understand what happens in the background. Everyone loves to drive the car, but nobody has to know what's happening into the engine. Nobody knows what's the cranking horsepower, what's the crankshaft size, what is the piston size. Nobody wants to know that. But nobody has to know that, right? Because the car runs fine. Now, I'm going to take you to the details of some of the aspects that will help you understand. So when I go and execute this on the black screen, now this is the command window where this is the hub on which everything runs. This is the good old Microsoft disk operating system, MS-DOS, in which you're looking at this, right? So in this, if I use a utility called traceroute, T-R-A-C-E-R-T, and write the name of the website. See what happens. Can anyone make a guess what's going on here? What's happening here is it starts from the unit from where the request is started, goes on to different areas in the network which are identified by these IP addresses and names that you're looking at. It goes to multiple locations and finally reaches the destination. Now, let's see what happens here. My system here, from which I executed a command, it hit 192.168.2.1. This is the IP address of my wireless router here. This wireless router receives the request and then forwards it to Optimum Online. Isn't that your experience at home? Because from your home laptop, when you execute something, it goes to your Internet service provider, your ISP. Now, when you access your internet service provider, what are the differences? Is there any difference in speed that they offer? Was it saying yes? There should be. So, what is the difference? 256 kbps. Okay. Anything else?
700.
Okay. Anyone else? What you and him are talking about is the network bandwidth that is provided by your service provider. So, next question that we have is, what are the various types of service providers? Have you heard about Optimum Online? Have you heard about Comcast? Have you heard about RCI? Have you heard about AOL? Have you heard about AT&T? These are all service providers. Verizon, these are all service providers. What is the difference in Verizon and AT&T and Comcast? They provide different types of bandwidth with different types of connection. Verizon has DSL. Verizon also has Fios. Right? So now you come to a different type.
Rekha Kumar
has joined the conference.
So everyone on call, are you in line with what I'm talking about? We're talking about different bandwidths that are offered by various service providers. Comcast has cable. Optimum Online also has cable, but they have different options for you to access the internet because they give you different connection bandwidth, right? Similarly, we want to know what, that's the next question, what are the various types of bandwidths to get connected to internet? So it's not only just your handheld device that works on 3G or 4G, there is also 4G LTE option for your handheld device. When you're working from home, you have internet service provider, which is a DSL, cable, or fiber. So we get connected. Now, let's go back to this. What are we looking at here? We are looking at the hops that are requests that you started from your browser to reach the destination. So your destination is Facebook.com, which has an IP address, which is 66.221.58.11. That's your destination source. Now, to reach that destination source, which is at the bottom on the 12th hop, the request has traversed so many areas and reached this destination. So when you look at the change from what you wrote and hit go and the page that got served to you, it has traveled half the globe to come back to you. Right? So this is what Cisco does best. That's why they are companies that make billions of dollars. Because they are able to get you the best, shortest route to reach your destination with all the calculations that they do all the time. So when on your system at home, you're trying to access anything using your browser, which is internet or intranet, based on the connection bandwidth that you have, you get connected to something called a web server. So when you write Facebook.com, you're connecting to the home page of Facebook.com website, which is hosting on a web server. So now, what is a web server? The web server is a specialized software sitting on a deep configuration. It has pretty high configuration. It has better RAM. It has better processing speed. It has better storage. It has better connection to the World Wide Web. There's a FAT type of T1, T3, or T5, which you will find out when you start looking at information about what are the various types of connection bandwidth. So the web server is hosting that website. Now we go to the question of what are the various types of websites. Web servers. So we have Microsoft, Netscape, Apache, Tomcat, etc., etc. There are so many of them. So that's my next question for you. What are the various type of web servers and their versions? So now we've understood the application architecture till the web server. But up to the web server is fine. But there is a lot more to the application. For example, when you're trying to work with Amazon.com, what happens? There are buyers, there are sellers. There are Amazon employees who are working on it. Amazon also has to make payments and receive payments. So all that also needs background support. And the background support is provided with the rest of the infrastructure that you have on the right side of this slide deck. You could be looking at application servers that are utilized in the application architecture. You would also have database server. You would also have ERP packages. So now, when we have a brief idea of the application architecture, now we can understand about quality assurance. So now, let's see what is quality assurance. I want some definitions from you. Yes, go ahead.
Just a question. Where do we come in? A QA analyst will be from the beginning of a particular project or, you know, will this come?
Okay, Praveena has a question and I want everyone to be attentive and give me a reaction on that. She is asking us a question, the role of QA, where does it start? What is QA? QA is quality assurance. So quality assurance, the sooner you start, the better it is. So in your application development process, if you engage the quality assurance to validate right from your requirement stage itself, you will eliminate the chances of errors which will arise due to incorrect requirements. So your requirements will be validated. If your requirements are correct and accurate, the rest of the streamlined process will also go very well. So earlier engagement of quality assurance people is always recommended. Alright? Alright, my next question that I have for you is, why and where does quality assurance come into play when we are looking at all this?
Why? In order to avoid defects, if there is any bugs in the project, in the code.
Just hold on your thought. Somebody still has their microphone on their system. Please disconnect or disable your microphone. There's a lot of echo.
Can you please repeat the question one more time? Ashish, this is Diana.
Diana, the question is, what is the role of quality assurance here and when will it get started in the system? So, Praveena, go ahead.
Okay. So, mainly it's like proactive, not reactive. We are ensuring that there is no problem, no issues or no bugs or defects in the code or in the, maybe in the requirements that we got. The quality assurance has to make sure that everywhere there is no problem and we have to fix if there is any problem.
Okay, so Faisal, what do you think?
I think you should start from the very beginning.
Okay.
And quality, make sure the product or services you are going to do have the quality and there's no mistake. And if there is a mistake, so you are like taking care of it on the go. Like, there you go.
Okay, all right. Anyone else who would like to mention something here? Anyone? So the role of quality assurance team members in this entire process is to make sure that the things work as expected.
Okay. Ashish?
Yes.
Excuse me. What you're saying is not clear, actually. I can hear the echo.
Someone has to switch off their system. You have to make sure that your speaker and your microphone on your laptops are set up accordingly. What I did on my system, please do it on yours as well.
Now it's clear?
Okay. Maybe I was the culprit. I'm sorry about that. So what we were looking at was, what is quality assurance? So quality assurance is making sure that with this infrastructure as the background and the software that is built, works as expected. And what's expected? As per the business requirements, as per the business owner who has worked with the business analyst and mandated, this is what I want. So, role of quality assurance is to make sure that the system works as expected. So, how do they do their role? They would do validation and verification. Right? So, validation will be whatever is the requirement, they are correct. Right? Now, the system is expected to be built in which they say that 100,000 users can be served from the infrastructure. The 100,000 users are never going to be concurrently active. Is the requirement correct? The requirement itself is not correct in that case, right? Because you are looking at a small application in which you have local office people who are going to work on that application. Why would you have that kind of requirement? Because if you have that kind of requirement, your cost of support for infrastructure, cost of development, everything goes up. So validation of the requirements has to be done, right? Then, when the system is built, you verify the requirement. My application, when a user has attempted 3 times to log into the system with incorrect details, you should be blocked. That's a requirement. You will verify that. So validation and verification are two important techniques that you need to use as a QA resource to certify that the application works as it. Right? Make sense? So that's the QA role that you have in the application. How do we execute that role? How does that QA team get formed? What are the roles of various team members in the entire group? How will I be a part of that group? What will be my career path? How will I grow in that path? All these things we'll cover up in a little moment from now. Right? So this big infrastructure, do you have any concerns on this, what we are looking at this point in time? Do you need any other understanding of this big infrastructure that we are looking at? So what happens is, there are some pre-existing solutions. For example, there may be a shopping cart that is required for your application. So instead of building that application on your own, you could plug in a third party service provider or a third party application that can be a part of your solution. For example, when you go buy something on Macy's.com, do you have any other option to make a payment other than Macy's card?
PayPal.
Very good example. And
even MasterCard.
Visa, Master, any other card service provider can be used. Mm-hmm. Do we write code for that every time? No. All we do is just call their service and ask them, this is a MasterCard that I am expecting a payment. So we just make a call, tell them, this is a MasterCard, this is the amount, tell me. Is it charged? That's it. You don't do anything else. So similarly, there are functions and features that can be plugged into your application architecture, which are built on these services here, which are specialized services, right? You do not write a shipping program. You just transfer the shipping request to UPS, DHL, USPS. They take care of it, everything, right? So if you want an application for e-commerce, you don't have to worry about writing a logistics program. You just need to partner with them, provide them information as they need it in their system. They will provide you hooks in their application, and your application will work seamlessly. Right? Make sense? Now, when you look at these various components in the application infrastructure, we will have quality assurance needs at each level. And when you start working on this, there are specialized tools that you will be able to use for different aspects of quality assurance. Now what we're going to do is walk you through the software development life cycle. The software development life cycle. Yes, who was that? Hi, who was that? Okay, all right. So what I'm showing you now is the high level software development lifecycle. Now, in software development lifecycle, what is software development lifecycle? From the beginning of the request, from concept to delivery of the finished product, that when you start breaking it down into various components, that's what is your software development lifecycle. So if you look at this here, the first highlighted object that you have towards the left of your screen is giving you a breakdown of the so-called master project plan, in which you will have requirements. What is requirement?
What does the client want?
Your name first, please. Okay, so Praveena says, requirements is basically
the client needs
the information or the content the client shares with you, which is requesting the system that they need to build. So that's your requirement. Your requirement can be, I will allow a valid user to access the system. If the user has attempted 3 times with invalid details, he has to start, or she has to start, not gender bias. The user will have to restart a session to try again. If the user has tried 3 times, he will be blocked for the day. A user will not be allowed to create an email address with the ID that already exists. These are all requirements in a system. Have you tried creating a new ID on your mail service provider with the same ID? It doesn't work. Because the requirement sets that as a background. The development team developed it on the basis of that. The QA team validated it. And finally, when it was rolled out to production, the actual application that has that feature. So requirements is nothing but the guidelines or the basis on which the application will be built. Alright? The next segment that we're looking at is feasibility analysis. What is feasibility analysis? That's basically making sure that what is required can be done. After that, we're looking at design. Now we start working on creating the framework for the application. Now the framework of the application will be, what will the screen look like? How will the technology support? Do I need Java? Do I need .NET? Do I need HTML? Do I need ColdFusion? What database do I need to use? What type of bandwidth do I need to get connected with? So that's all the design work. After design is done, then you start building the application. Building the application is a part of development team. The development team will have developers. They will have junior developers, senior developers, architect level people. Right? We'll be working on that. And once the application is kind of built, then you start testing. Right? That's where the quality assurance team comes into play. There are various roles. Now, once the application is tested, then you're ready to go live. When the application goes live, what happens? Big celebration. Yay! Alright. But with those celebrations come some responsibilities as well. Now the responsibility is that you listen for the problem the customer has. So you will look at issues that are post-production. Right? You'll maintain those. You will have enhancements that will be requested in the system. And then once you have met the lifespan of the system, it could be that the technology has become redundant. The business is itself wound up. Business has moved on to a different area. For example, you were working on client-server application earlier. Now you are going to be web. So whatever are the systems that you have, they may sunset because there's no more life in that system. It will be sunset case. So all this is basically your software development lifecycle. So try and read about software development lifecycle on Wikipedia. That's another question, which is a hint. What is software development lifecycle? So software development lifecycle is nothing but going through the stages that we've just discussed here. And you can go into large number of details at each step, depending on what is your area of interest. So what we're going to focus on is the testing and quality assurance aspect of the software development lifecycle in this training program. So So testing and quality assurance begins right from step one when the requirements are being drafted. So what is the various activities that we do? First, we will identify the scope of testing. Now, scope of testing can be various options that you're looking at here. It can be regression, function, stress, performance, load. There's a lot more that you have here, which is basically nothing else but types of testing. So that's the next question. What are the various types of testing that will be executed on an application? You could also be going into validation testing, which is you validate your requirements. But are these correct? Are these requirements workable or not? Are these requirements feasible? All that will be done in the scope of testing itself. Regression. These are a few important things that have been highlighted here, but there's a lot more types of testing that you need to do. So what is regression? Regression is you get the application, you start working on testing it, and you find some defects in it. What do you do with the defects? You have to fix it. But when the defects get fixed and a new version is delivered to you, what do you do then? You test only the new ones or you test the old ones as well?
The existing ones are
done. The existing that were passed earlier and the new ones that have been delivered to you, you will have to do a test on everything. That's what is called regression testing. So you regress on what was passed earlier. So let's say there were 10 test cases. Of those 10 test cases, 2 failed and 8 passed. So when the next build comes in, you will not just test the 2 that are fixed, but you will also test the other 8 that was given to you, which were working fine. And why do you want to do that? Everything works as expected. That's the most important aspect of quality assurance, right? So regression testing is to retest everything that was previously certified as testing with the new build, right? Okay, so what is functional testing? Online team members. Yeah, who is this?
This is Priya.
Yes, Priya, go ahead.
Yeah, functional testing is, I mean, what are all the functions in the application, we are testing those functions.
Okay, the features and functions, when they get tested, that's what is functional testing. Now,
okay.
For example, you are testing security of the application. The security of the application can be done by opening the app, providing user ID, providing password, and clicking submit. You can change the values that you use for user ID. User ID and password can be different, right? So a function is a set of steps that can be executed by varying data. You're still doing the same thing. When you want to test, user number 1 can access, user number 2 can access, user number 3 cannot access. All you're doing is doing the same steps, but you're changing the data in the steps. That's what is called functional testing. And of course, it functions as expected. Right?
So for example, if I'm going to withdraw cash, pregnant here, if I'm going to withdraw cash from
a bank account,
so the, you know, in functional testing, the process should be like, you know, login, click withdraw, you know, the minimum amount should be balanced, make it or whatever, and then once you withdraw, the remaining balance and the withdrawal amount will be displayed.
Right.
So is this what?
This is also functional testing, because what will happen is user 1, you will test with some data, user 2 with different data set, but the steps will be same.
Yeah, okay.
So in mathematics, when I do a function of x is equal to y plus 2, what does that mean? Any value that I substitute for y, add 2 to that, the value of x will be available to me. So what I've done by defining a function? A series of steps in which there are variables. And these variables have a relation. Right? And based on this relation, when I provide an input, the output will be served. So that's functional testing. Stress testing. I'm under a lot of stress.
Why does that happen?
Is it me or Lord is not a thing?
Okay. So stress testing is testing the system for a volume of activity over a period of time. So when you're running stress test, what you're doing is you are putting stress on the system, whatever is the user activity that you define for an extended period. For example, Google is trying to do some stress test on their application. Their normal usage is 1 million hits per hour. I'm just giving you orbit numbers. So these 1 million hits that Google is serving for the request for search, we will run that 1 million requests per hour for 6 hours, 8 hours, 20 hours, 24 hours. So what you're doing is you're stressing the system beyond its normal usage. That's called a stress test. Why do we execute stress tests? Because we want to find out if there are any problems in the system when the usage gets extended. A classic example that I refer to every time in each batch, 911. Under that condition, at 911, 90% of the communication systems just melted. Because no one tested them at those levels. AT&T network blocked. Verizon network blocked. You couldn't call anyone. Because the volume of traffic that was there on the infrastructure at that particular moment in time, no one anticipated. That's why the system just broke down. Then, what is performance test? Yeah, go ahead.
So another example, like sometimes, you know, if there's a news about a system that, for example, like ABC, go check ABC on Google, and it's on the news, it's everywhere. Stress test is done for a billion, and all of a sudden, you have 2 million people. People going on that same website and
will
crash.
Right, that's absolutely right. That is why we do these kind of tests, so that we know when will the system break. For example, Macy's.com website has a business cycle.
Right.
It is entertaining a volume of traffic on a regular basis. What happens when Mother's Day comes,
right.
Father's Day comes, then Christmas comes up, Valentine's Day comes up. Volume of activity just spikes up. So if they do not test for those extended volumes of activity, what will happen? It will crash the website, they will lose business. If they lose business, their profitability goes down. If profitability goes down, the stock market punishes them, their stock takes a beating. Everything is interlinked.
I thought, like, in the performance testing, only we'll see that whether the system can handle that amount of pressure. That number of logins.
Stress, performance and load are load volume related testing. But they are different types of testing. Performance is when you're looking at the application returning to you in a expected response time. So how much is the user response? That's what is performance.
The time
taken for that. Page to provide that response. Then what is load? You are subjecting the application with increased activity. So if your normal volume of activity is 1 million hits a day, you're doing 1 million, 1.25 million, 1.5 million, 1.752 million, and see what happens. That's load test. So we will define the scope of what type of testing we need to do. Then we'll define coverage. What is coverage? Online team members, please be actively engaged. I don't hear anyone. Hello? What is coverage? We will define the coverage by identifying what we have built as a team. For example, that I gave you, PayPal. You're not testing functionality of PayPal. You're not testing functionality of DHL or UPS. You're testing what you have developed. So that's where you will define your coverage. Then, method, manual or automated. Automated is running your steps that are in manual in an automation tool. Then, what iterations we need to execute? Unit testing, system testing, integration testing. These are all
types of testing that you will look at when you define it. Then what tools do we have to use? After we've defined that, we need to understand the exit criteria. Why do we need exit criteria? Because we want to define. Till when will we keep testing? Any system, whichever is built, ever, is not bug-free. Ever. 100% certification can never happen for any application, unless it is NASA. There they can't have any tolerance. So this will define your fault tolerance. Fault tolerance can vary from a system to another system. For example, a trading website cannot have fault tolerance. Zero fault tolerance. Your trading trade, you cannot risk anything there, right? There's a timeline. Why do we need a timeline? Because you meet the demand of business to launch our product, right? And then, of course, we make some assumptions so that we define the assumptions, we don't make as of you and me. Right? So this is bottom line of the testing team engagement. Where they'll define the scope, they'll define the coverage, they'll define method of testing. Any questions? So this is where the role of QA team member will fall in one of these areas here. Now, after we have done this, now we need to build our team. How will we build our team? Hiring manager or the QA project manager or the overall project manager will initiate a dialogue. And the dialogue will be to identify resources. How will we identify resources? Based on this scope. What type of testing has to be done? What is the application technology? Right? I am working on a financial services application which is built on Java. Right? And this application needs functional testing and performance testing. That's the project level definition. This definition or request will go to HR. And we are looking for testers who have experience in testing financial applications on Java. You start the human resources. Human resources coordinates the broadcast of the request. Your vendors will get the request. Vendors will go to their sub-vendors. Identify resources that qualify for the requirement that you have. They'll come back. You will then interview them. So this is the process where resume will be selected. Resume will be screened, submitted, and then interview process will start. Once interviews are done, then you will be part of the team. Once you are part of the team, you will be provided some training. And the training will be on business rules. Right? What is expected when you execute this type of step? What is the response? There will be some training that you will be provided on the application. All this is coordinated by the QA manager. The QA manager is responsible for floating the requirements, getting the staff appropriated and selected, train the staff, and have the team ready as soon as the application is available for quality assurance. Any questions here? Online team members, any questions here?
No.
Are you clear with what we have done here so far?
Ashish, this is Reena here. Can you please tell me what is exit criteria?
Exit criteria, okay. Exit criteria basically defines what will be your final goal of the effort that you have. Reena.
Okay.
Exit criteria is we will keep testing till we have 99% of the functionality working correct. Right? Does that help?
Okay. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's go on to the next segment of this where we have now created our team and we need to start working on how we want to approach. Next thing after we have created the team will be our test plan. Why do we need a plan? Anyone? Why do we need a plan for anything? Online team members, anyone, why do we need a plan?
To
write the, all the requirements?
Break down entire activity into well-coordinated steps. Right? If you have to have a get-together, do you plan a party? Yes, you do. And what do you do in planning? I identify my guests. I identify my food. How do I coordinate my food? How do I manage the parking for all these guests? What time they will come in? When they will go out? What will happen to the cleaning services? Do I need to hire a banquet? All these are aspects of the plan. Similarly, when you want to build a plan for testing, you have various aspects that you need to worry about. We've already defined the scope earlier, what we are testing, how we are testing, all that is done. But now, we are now building a test plan at what is going to happen, when is it going to happen, how is it going to happen, who is going to do it, and how it will be done. What, when, where, who, and how will be defined in your test plan. You'll create a plan. Plan is something that you can change in course of time for making corrections or amendments. Plan is not something that is set in stone. Is everyone in agreement with this?
Yep.
So what we have to do here is to define a plan. And what does the plan do for me? It will tell me what, when, where, how, and who of each aspect. So when we talk about a test plan, we look at requirements. From the requirements, we'll identify what scenarios are required. What is a scenario? Scenario is a use case. A valid user can access the system. Invalid user cannot access the system. 3 invalid attempts will block the user. Right? A user cannot draw more than amount of money in the bank. It has to be less than the minimum expected, right? So there are various aspects of requirements that you need to meet. So that will be from your scenarios. Each of these scenarios will have a test case associated with it. A valid user has access. You'll have a valid user ID, valid password. You'll try for multiple users and multiple passwords to access the system. Then you will define your test steps. What is a test step? The step that the user, the testing user, the test engineer will follow. All that is part of your test plan. Then, when you have created your scenarios, you will now, in these scenarios, define in your test cases what are the steps and what is the expected result. Because remember, testing is to hold confirmation of system working as expected. So you need expected results as well. When you are looking at expected results, you will validate your assumptions, because your assumptions are a valid user has access to the system and can send an email. All that will be validated across steps, right? So that's the detailed test plan. This test plan aspect that you're looking at here is managed in a tool called Quality Center. What I'm going through these steps is the quality assurance lifecycle. What we saw earlier was software development lifecycle. Now we're going through the quality assurance lifecycle. So in quality assurance lifecycle, there are various tools that will come into play. Quality Center is a tool that will allow us to plan. Not only plan, now it has expanded in scope. It will help you manage requirements. It will help you manage test scenarios, test cases, test steps, test data. It will also allow you to run your test cases quality center. And it will also allow you for tracking the defects or bugs. All that is done in quality center. Next thing that we're looking at is our testing environment. Why do we need a testing environment? Why can't we test in production? Or test in development environment? Why do we need a separate QA environment? Because We would like to test on stable code. That should not be changing all the time. Because in development, there are changes that are being made at regular intervals. Every developer is making a change and adding it to the application. We cannot work on a moving target. Because if you identify a defect and that defect gets fixed in the next rollout the developer is doing, then what will happen? The defect that you found becomes invalid. Right? So what we do is we create a separate quality assurance environment where we will accept the build and when we need them. So change in that environment will happen only when you are authorized to get an incremental build, which is a part of the plan that you build. So in this you have QA architecture, which is defining the tools that you will use, these are all the tools. Then you will have the test system, also called AUT, which is application under test, or SUT, which is system under test. That will be there in the quality environment. Then you will have data. Why would you need data? Because without data, you cannot validate anything. Right? For example, you want to test Google. What does Google do? Search it. So if you do not have search data to support the search term, what is the use? Data is needed, right? Then control test data. Control test data are data items that will allow you to validate high-level functionality. For example, a system administrator is needed in the environment when you want to create the user roles. That control data should always exist. This is one example. Right? A bank account must exist for you to execute a bank transaction. To control data. Right? So who are the people who are responsible for that? You have a QA architect responsible for building the system for you, who will deploy and apply changes to the system. Then you have QA analyst. You want to be in the QA training? Please. A little late because we started. So we have a QA architect who is responsible for doing the installation, deploying the application changes. Then you have a QA analyst. What is a QA analyst?
Analyze the whole thing.
QA analyst has various roles. QA analyst will create the test scenarios, test cases, test data. QA analyst will also analyze the requirements. QA analyst will also execute. QA analyst will also report. That's the QA analyst role. What's the business analyst doing here?
Ashish, hello. This is Rupa. I'm sorry to interrupt. I was having a little audio problem. A little bit of echo as well, so I mean, just wondering if anybody else is having this problem or is it my phone?
Does anyone else
have? I've been wondering, my system, but even I've been having a lot of haziness and disturbance. Rekha here?
Yeah, me too. Yeah, this is Priya. When I got the same problem, the voice is breaking up.
The only thing that I can suggest is check your systems and make sure that you don't have speakers and microphones on your system. That's all. That's the only thing I can suggest.
Ashish, earlier when you did something, it was okay.
Please make sure that you have that on. Another thing that I can suggest is if your phone, handphone set that you are using has a mute button, please mute that. Hello?
Yeah, still I can hear the echo, Ashish.
Well, if you can mute your phone, then when you want to speak, you can do that.
Yeah, I'm doing that actually.
Okay.
Even I'm doing, Ashish, it's better now.
Okay, all right.
It's much better, Ashish. Thank you.
Okay, all right. Thank you.
Thank you.
So we look at the QA resources. We're talking about business analysts. So, Praveena, what do you think of the business analyst?
Providing the test data master of the details that is required by a QA analyst for testing.
Business analyst has a much wider role than what you just mentioned. It's not only just looking at data provisioning, but also helping clarify any doubts that come up in requirements or the concerns that the developers have regarding a requirement, go back to the code and ask them to clarify those. So the business analyst role that you have is a user, a part of the system, who is going to clarify and build requirements. Clean the call, right?
I was just talking from this point of view. I was thinking, VA will provide the use cases from which a QA analyst will have the test cases.
That's done here, right?
Yeah.
Right, absolutely right. Okay. But if there is any ambiguity in understanding of the requirements, or implementation question, or data concern, all that will be addressed by the developer. Of course, you have developers who are building the solution and giving you the solution. So that's what is happening in the QA test environment.
Priya has joined the conference.
Guys, please make sure that you're on mute when you join. Because what happens is if you're not on mute, you will have feedback in the system and it will not be good recording. Kindly make sure that you're on mute. Someone is still not on mute. Please make sure your laptops and your handsets that you're using are on mute and you can unmute them when you want to ask a question. So the next segment that we're looking at now is the execution part. We have our test plan, we have made our test scenarios, cases, data. Now we want to start executing our test. Now, depending on the scope that we defined earlier, we start executing our test. And once we execute our test, we will aggregate the results and present it to the team. The team will decide what are found as defects or defects that need to be fixed. They can be deferred or they will have to be fixed now before the application goes. That's the execution aspect. If you don't tell me your name, I don't know who you
are. On real-time scenario, do the development and testing happen at the same time in any of the projects?
Well, there are different methodologies that have been developed over a period of time. Mm-hmm. What you are referring to is a classic condition where there are various stages in the software development lifecycle. So development will complete and then QA will start. That's one option. That's called waterfall methodology. Another question that comes up is what are the various types of development methodologies? Waterfall is everything goes step by step. Then you have something called agile. That things move parallel. Development and QA will start working together. What happens in that case? Part is developed and tested simultaneously. You don't have to wait for the entire application to be ready for QA to get started. Of course, the synergies in both the methodologies are different, the impact is different, and the results are different. We need to be aware on what type of methodology has been adopted and how it is going to be helpful. Typical examples when you're looking at offshore on-site model will have waterfall. But in some cases, even sprint is working very well. Agile development. Again, please make sure that you are on mute. If I hear my voice again, that means somebody has their system that's not on mute. See, I can mute everyone from here, but then you will not be able to ask me any questions. Well,
Priya Javalkar
has joined the conference.
Please make sure that you have your systems on mute. So this is the slide deck which looks at the hardcore activity of. We have executed our test, now we start analyzing. In analysis, we will understand what is going on. We will analyze the results. How will we get the results? By executing the test, by executing the results.
Oh,
yes.
Ashish.
Yes.
Oh, it's too much actually, the echo.
Yes,
I wish
Ashish.
I can't echo
Ashish.
Okay, let me do one thing. Okay, let's do one thing. We go step by step and we'll check for everyone. Vasanthi, is your system on mute?
Yeah, both my system and phone are on mute.
Okay, no one speaks. Only the person that I'm talking to will speak, all right? Vasanthi, are you good?
Yeah.
Vasanthi?
Yeah, my system. Both muted.
Okay. Let me try to do one more thing here. Okay, now the next person that I want to talk to is Sandhya. Is your system on mute?
Yes, my system is on mute.
Sai Kumar. Rekha?
Yeah, I'm on mute.
No, you're not. See the echo that you have?
God, what is this?
Are you there? On your laptops, please make sure that your volume, your microphone and your speakers both are on mute. Reena, can you please check?
Both my systems are on.
Priya, can you please check?
For me, my system is on mute.
Both are muted.
Okay, Nupur.
I'm on mute, Ashish.
Lee, can you also check, please? Gopika? Faz is here. Diana, can you please check?
Yeah, my phone is on mute and on the system I haven't switched a microphone at all.
Amol, can you check yours as well? Amol? Hi, Amol. Okay, Amol recommends that we disconnect and we reconnect. So, I'm going to close this call and everyone dial in again, please.
Okay.